So I'm going to present you a joint work with Mathieu Levin and Phan Tam Nam, which is also, so to say, this joint work with Jürg Fröhlich, Antin Noors, Benjamin Schlein and Vedran Soehinger, by which I mean that they obtained exactly, well, up to epsilon, the same result as us, at exactly the same time with a completely orthogonal method. So if you like the result I'm going to present but dislike the method of proof, the best piece of advice I have is that you go check their papers. And actually, they've announced some new results very recently, though there is a talk by Antin Noors on the IIMP worldwide seminar. Okay, and there's also, I should mention, some work by Andy Deutschert, Robert Seyringer, and Jakob Ingvarsson, to which what I'm going to say can be compared, but the comparison is not exactly straightforward, so I'm not going to go into that during the talk. So since I would forget anyway to mention them, I mention them right away. Okay, so I'll be talking about, I do everything grand canonically, so it's the grand canonical ensemble for bosons in the unit flat torus in 3D. So what we do is actually much more general, but to have a notation reasonably under control, I will just focus on this case. We could do inhomogeneous gases, and we could do 2D also, but let's stick to a particular example. So let me recall a little bit what Mathieu said in his lecture. So the Hilbert space on which everything will be living is the Fock space, bosonic Fock space, so a direct sum of all possible spaces for many bosons. So little n denotes the particle number, and I can consider any superposition of states with different particle numbers. And since they are bosons, the states, the basic states, are wave functions, complex valued, and symmetric under exchange of their arguments. So, as you heard in several lectures already. So I have a Hamiltonian. It will be called a big H. Perhaps I put a subscript lambda for the coupling constant, and it starts like d gamma of minus Laplacian. So get used to this funny notation because I cannot help but use it. So I will define it. But that's what you've seen in other lecture. And then a coupling constant lambda and some interaction W. So d gamma is a sort of standard notation to say that I take minus Laplacian, so this periodic boundary condition, and I lift it to this space in the natural way. So it's it acts diagonally on the sectors with different particle numbers, and on a sector with n particles, it's the sum j from 1 to n minus Laplace in the variable xj. And the interaction is also the natural lifting of a two-pair interaction on this big space. So the big W is the big sum for all particle number sectors and the sum over pairs of a pair potentials which acts as a multiplication on functions of this space. Of course, I'm living on the torus, right? So this is this xi minus xj is really the distance on the torus. All right, so there is a coupling constant. Perhaps I want to recall that there is another important operator that will show up, which is a number operator, which is just defined as a direct sum of n identity over L2 tensor n times. All right, so this is supposed to be a calligraphic n. Okay, and so we deal with a positive temperature, so we are interested in the Gibbs state. So, as we've seen already, I will denote it by gamma lambda. So it's 1 over a number, z lambda, e to the minus 1 over t, d operator, minus nu, which is yet another number, particle number. Right, so T is temperature. Nu is a chemical potential, so these are bosons, so nu must be here negative. So this, you see, is e to the minus an operator, so this is a trace class operator, positive trace class operator over this space, and the z lambda is the partition function which makes the trace equal to 1, so the usual convention.
Nicolas?
Yes?
Is nu really negative in your case? Because we have the interaction.
Sorry?
You have an interaction which might shift.
Yeah, that's right. So maybe I would say this, I would put this later, yeah. I think you're right that it's better to. But my note says it's actually negative, but anyway. Perhaps I can squeeze in here some assumption that I will have all the way through the talk, but that I will always forget to recall. So I will assume positive Fourier transform for this operator, for this guy, which is convenient for us. And I will assume some regularity. So, okay. Let me record the exact notation, notion we need. That if you take the Fourier coefficients of this guy, this sum, weighted sum, must be finite. But okay, for the purpose of the talk, just think that W is smooth. I don't really care too much about the optimal assumption. Okay, a bit of notation that I will use all the time also is that I will denote expectations in a state, for example, so in this state, expectation of dot, which is so, if I take some operator, bounded operator, for example, on the Fock space, this will always mean trace of this operator against gamma lambda. So the standard quantum mechanical expectation value. Good, and for the purpose, or maybe not the statements, but the proofs, it's important to recall that this gamma lambda, this e to the minus something, doesn't just come out of the blue. The reason why we're interested in this form is that this minimizes the free energy, which I think physically should not really be called free energy, but I will use free energy anyway. So namely, it's a functional over state. So gamma is a positive self-adjoint operator with trace 1 on the Fock space. So since it's a complex Hilbert space, if it's positive, it's automatically self-adjoint. It's a nice lemma. This is free energy, so it's energy, then minus the action of the chemical potential. So this is, if you want, expected value of the energy corrected by chemical potential. And then minus temperature times entropy. I call the entropy, I mean, it's the usual formula, minus integral rho log rho. So I warn PD people amongst you that I'm using the physics convention, that the entropy is really what gets produced and not dissipated. And this is just the quantum mechanical analog, so trace gamma log gamma. And that will be used, that will be used a lot in our proof. Okay. So next, this workshop is about scaling limits, right? So now I will scale my parameters. And I think in the abstract I announced that it's a toy model for looking at the BEC phase transition. Rather than toy model, I would like to say toy scaling, because you see the model is the bona fide exact model, but what we will play around with are these three parameters that I've put. So there is lambda, there is nu, and there is temperature. So what I will do is that I will just write down the scaling and then spend a few minutes explaining what it does. Because it's not supposed to be immediately obvious that what I'm going to write down is the relevant thing to do. And it's not the unique relevant thing to do anyway. So I'm going to call this a mean field limit, because that's what it is. Which, in this situation, will mean to me T temperature to infinity. But the reason I do this is that particle number is not fixed. So taking temperature to infinity, in fact, is the way we impose actually it. You should really think of it as particle number going to infinity. So I will explain this in a moment. Then, as you might expect, there is a scaling of the coupling constant so that things balance in a nice way. So it's lambda will be like will be 1 over t. So this goes to 0. And then the funny part is the chemical potential. Well, as Mathieu explained at length, when you do grand canonical ensemble, the choice of the chemical potential, I mean, you have to be a little bit careful about what you take to achieve what you want. So it will be a funny number. Well, not funny for those who have already heard about BEC. So zeta 3 half, don't worry, so it's the Riemann zeta function, but it's just a number, over 8, if I'm not making any mistake, pi to the 3 half. Then I need to put here Fourier transform the interaction at 0, lambda minus a half, and minus some mu 0, fixed. So this is fixed. And I claim, and I will explain, that this means that in some sense, I'm zooming before the BEC phase transition. Well, except, of course, I'm in finite volume, so this is not a proper phase transition. You can call that a quasi-phase transition, like they do in condensed matter physics.
May I ask, so there is a minus in front of the chemical potential? Mm-hmm.
Yes.
So this tends to minus infinity?
This tends to minus infinity, yes.
Ah, okay.
Now I have a doubt. Yeah, it's probably a plus here. Or probably it's a plus over there. Okay, so it's the way that makes sense. So what I want to explain is, you should subtract something from the Hamiltonian, not add something. So the sign that makes sense is plus here.
So is the idea that the new really goes to infinity or minus infinity, not to zero?
Oh, sorry, not zero. What did I do? Oh, it's infinity. Yes, okay, it's through infinity. Okay, so to motivate that I'm zooming before the phase transition, I will consider the free Gibbs state. And I start to motivate that this is really like taking n to infinity. So look at the free Gibbs state. Namely, so gamma 0 will be the guy with, so let's be careful, it's w equal to 0, not just lambda equal to 0, because you see, if I put lambda equal to 0 here, I'm in trouble. So the notation, I hope, is not too confusing. When I say gamma lambda, it means it has a w, and I will say gamma 0, it means it doesn't have the w. So let's look at this one. And so it does neither. This guy has this new zero. Oh, okay, I think I'd better write it down. So gamma zero is 1 over a partition function, exponential minus 1 over t d gamma of the Laplacian in the notation I had above, plus new zero particle number. Okay. Then what do we want to do? You want to look at the expected number of particles in this guy. That's also I would denote expectations in this guy with zero. So it doesn't have a fixed particle number. So you would like to know what is the expected particle number. And that's where this funny number comes from, is that it's this, if my notes are correct at least, is t to the 3 half. Okay, let me write it down once. Zeta 3 half. It's really a dreadful constant. 2 to the 3 half. whatever. That's leading order. So that goes to infinity when t goes to infinity with the scaling it should have. And then there is a correction, which is t times some function of nu zero that I will not define precisely because it's not really relevant what it is, but it's like that. And then you have still a lower order correction, which is, if I make no mistake, is t to the 1/2. So this, if you remember Matthew's lecture, I don't think he had the expression with zeta to the 3/2, but this is the expression when you do the calculation from the formula Matthew had. This is the expression of the critical density for BEC. So let me call it rho c of t. So which really means that BEC, maybe I recall, it means that note that I'm on the torus with a fixed size, so particle number and density is the same form. So it means that if I take the expectation value of the number of operator in the zero Fourier mode, say in the free state, this is supposed, so maybe I put quotation marks because that's not the thermodynamic thing, this is supposed to be larger than a fixed constant, that's the total expected number of particles if if rho is less than rho c of t, is larger than rho c of t. So that's the number you get from the calculations in the thermodynamic limit. This n0 is the guy which acts as on each sector, it acts as it projects on each particle on the constant function. So this is an orthogonal projector on the constant function. Okay, so the leading order of the particle number is really this critical density. And then I have a correction here, which is non-positive. So basically, all you need to know about this function phi. So phi, I really don't want to define because it's really just a remake. It's really the error you make when you approximate the Riemann sum Matthew had yesterday by the corresponding integral. So it's really it has an expression, but it's not very relevant. What is important is that this is non-positive, that phi is, I guess, it's positive and it's decreasing. Okay. So that, I hope, explains why I take t to infinity, because it's convenient to set so t to infinity with this nu zero fixed. So to say, sets the system just before the phase transition. So now I want to explain what nu does. Because when I'm going to switch on the interaction, in fact, if I switch on the interaction and do nothing about it, if I don't take a nu of this form, I will see nothing interesting. The reason why this is that, so why the choice of nu is that if you just consider the bare interaction, by which I mean this lambda w, and you take the expectation, say in the free state, just to get an idea. Well, of course, this is a two-particle operator, so this will look like the expectation of the particle number squared, which will look like, well, if you believe this, it will be like lambda t to the 3. So it's not so much that it's too big, but this is independent of nu zero. So I've set a parameter which is supposed to help me look at things finely, but if I look just at the leading order of the interaction, then I don't see the parameter. So it's probably you could expand to next leading order, but we find it much more convenient to just remove something, which would make the interaction talk not to this guy, but to this guy, which is the relevant one to go to the phase transition. So what do you do? When you see something like that, what you want to do is renormalize, so to say, that you take, I will be more precise later, but I want to take a renormalized interaction, which will be like, so the bare one, and the chemical potential is used to, so to say, dump this this guy in such a manner that if I take the expectation, yes, this will look like some energy reference that I don't care, and that I will obtain just by completing a square. So, namely, something like I want this to look like, so at this level of precision, I want it to look like this. I want it to look like a variance. So, quotation marks, this is just a heuristic, but that's what I want. So, this energy reference is a constant, I can just drop it each time I see it. It doesn't set the state, it just sets the energy reference. But what is important is that I want this, is that I want to have the variance. And if you compute the variance of the particle number, you will see that it will really talk to this guy. And then this is going to be like lambda t squared. And now it depends on nu zero, so that's good. So then I can tune nu zero and see something.
Can I still ask a question about the scaling? So you have the 1 over t in front of the Laplacian, and you take it to 0. So if you had if you put in all physics constants, you would have 1 over the usual temperature, and then you would have an h bar squared term. Mm-hmm. Laplacian.
Mm-hmm.
So is this in some sense semi-classical what you're doing?
I think you can think of it like that, although I will not obtain a really bona fide classical model. But I mean, since I've removed all units, I can play around with parameters a little bit.
Yeah, but I'm just trying to make a connection, and it seems to me, is it very important for you that the coefficient of the Laplacian term is really vanishing in your limit that you're doing, right?
I'm not sure I can put it like that.
But it's what it says, right? Lambda is 1 over t.
But you see that I will very soon sort of get rid of the Laplacian. So I'm not sure I really want to enter this discussion. Because you can really write this indifferently. As you said, you can also take h bar to 0. You can do different things. But
well, it certainly looks like a limit h bar to 0.
Yeah, I think you can formulate it like that. Okay. But it can be confusing because it's not going to be now a limit theory on phase space. So it's not going to be an XP limiting theory. So that's why I prefer not to take h bar to 0. Because to me, h bar to 0 really means that you get to the phase space and not no longer quantum mechanics. Okay, so the last choice I have to motivate is the choice of lambda. And this one is really for convenience. So usually in multiple limits, when we choose an interaction constant, it's just to set things right so on the same scale. Here is just, I just want to explain a little bit what it is that we set right. Is that let me put it like that. If you take the difference between free energies of the interacting state and the free energy in the non-interacting state, so I hope the notation is clear. This means the free energy without interaction. And it's really the difference that we should think of it. So both terms would diverge very fast in my limit, so it's really the difference that makes sense. And this you can write exactly as t. This that I will define, plus of course we still have lambda. And for the purpose of this discussion, let me just put the quotation marks again, and it will look like lambda, something of the sort, this expectation. So this is the von Neumann relative entropy. That's trace of gamma, log gamma, minus log gamma 0. And it's nice because it's a positive quantity, it's coercive, it has a Pinsker inequality, so it's a good quote-unquote metric to measure how far your interacting state is from the non-interacting one. So what am I doing with lambda equals 1 over t? You have to see this like, this is lambda t squared.
And what will happen in the limit is that with the variational principle, you can very easily prove that this term, whatever it does, will be of the same order of magnitude of this as this one. So by taking lambda equals 1 over t, it means that what I will have is that this quantity here is a row of 1. So it's just convenient to think that there is this thing that measures the distance between your two states and it's going to be of order 1. But otherwise, the choice of lambda is just, as I say, just for convenience. Good. So perhaps I will save some notation around this, around here. So I'm going to clean up the notation a little bit. What you can do with all these choices, in particular with this new chosen, so new, you see it's chosen basically to give you some expectation of the free particle number in the free state in your energy, so that when it's chosen like that, you can complete a square in the way I wrote here. But now I'm going to write exactly what you get, so that we are all agree on the notation. So now I will really be dealing with the H lambda that I really want to think of this form. So it becomes d gamma to the minus Laplace plus kappa. And I will tell you in a minute what kappa is. It's fixed and it's positive. Then I have lambda over 2, a sum over k, a Fourier coefficient of wk, and some absolute square of, okay, d gamma of ek, I will define, minus expectation of d gamma of ek in the zero state, and okay, that's a square. And then plus an energy reference that I will forget all the time because I don't care, it doesn't modify the Gibbs state. So what goes on in here? I have d gamma of ek is so ek means for me multiplication by the plane wave of parameter k, and d gamma means it's lifted to the Fock space. So this is the usual big sum. A sum over all particles of e to the I k dot xj. Right, so as a multiplication operator. So if I don't have this in the square, this sum w hat of k d gamma of ek squared, you can figure out that it's modulo constant exactly the big W I had before. It's just a rewriting. And this completion of square is the one that I did clumsily here. And when you do it right, that's how it comes about. Now, these are expectations in the non-interacting state, which is translation invariant. So actually, this number is non-zero only for k equal to 0. The reason I record it for any k is that what I did here, you can do it also in inhomogeneous systems. And then this number needs not be 0 unless k is equal to 0. So I want to keep the notation like that, even though it's a little bit redundant, because this number, you are just renormalizing the zero energy mode, in fact. And then I wanted to define kappa also. So kappa, you see, when you have here, you have to choose nu to fit the leading order of the particle number here. Then you have this nu zero. So kappa comes about by saying nu zero. Nu zero is really what I give myself physically. And then kappa is what comes out in the limiting model. And you have to be a bit careful because in fact, you find it by taking nu zero as a function of kappa. It must be equal to kappa plus w hat of 0 root kappa over 4 pi minus phi of kappa with this. If I didn't make any mistake. I ask you to believe me because I'm not going to make a fool of myself by trying to do the calculation at the board. But if you take the parameters like that, modulo a constant, this is exactly the operator I started from.
And again, since probably I will forget not to erase the other board, I'm interested in E to the minus. Now, 1 over T in this form, just H lambda. Well, perhaps the notation is a bit confusing, but here I have included the chemical potential in it. Okay, so now, time is running fast, of course. What to expect? Now I want to take the limit of this problem, and hopefully see something interesting. I think this is the less useful part, actually. So what you expect, in fact, what you can do, which is not what we did at first, actually, but you can go to the physics literature. In particular, I think the crucial work is by Gordon Baim, Marcus Holtzman, Laloé, Vautrin, and Blaiseau, and then there were follow-ups. So this was in 2000. This is they were calculating the correction, the interaction-driven correction to the critical density of the Bose gas. And they do this by zooming just before the phase transition, but of course they do it in a much more challenging regime, namely they do it thermodynamic limit first, and then dilute limit, so rho to zero, density to zero. But then what they claim and what they, prove in a physics sort of way, there is very heavy experimental and numerical evidence that it's correct. So you expect classical field theory to be the correct limit. So basically what this means is that you take the natural equivalent of this, where you replace every operator by functions. Perhaps in the in vocabulary which is more suited to mathematicians, it means positive T equilibria of NLS theory, or Gross-Pitayevsky, if you want, if you are willing not to make the distinction as Matthew did yesterday.
Nicola?
Yes?
Quick question. You say there's experimental evidence for that. What do people measure? Do they measure critical exponents?
Maybe I was talking too much. Maybe I was talking too much for this. I think there is. But I would have to ask Marcus again about what they measure. But the numerical evidence is really overwhelming. So what does that mean? NLS theory is this, of course, it's based on this PDE. So it's a time-dependent equation. And by positive T equilibria, you sort of mimic what you had before. You take, this is an Hamiltonian equation. It has an energy which is integral grad u squared plus, in this convention, half this double integral. So it's a smeared non-NLS for me because it's easier. But of course, physicists actually mean the point-like NLS, the local one. So positive T equilibria means that you're going to take a measure over the state space of this equation, which should look like, so it's a measure, supposed to be a measure of functions. It's going to be a normalization constant, exponential minus, so in Manikovian convention, the effective temperature is going to be 1, so you would like to do this. Du. Now, of course, this expression has lots of problems, and you have to cure them. So the first thing you will do, so you see this is nonsensical because I'm not on a lattice, right? So this du doesn't mean anything. It should supposed to be Lebesgue measure over L2 that doesn't exist. So what you want to do is that you want to write this mu du. So there are two terms here. You want to separate them. So it's exponential minus integral grad u squared du. So written like that, it's still nonsensical. But then exponential minus half integral w u squared times u squared.
Now it's a little bit better because this is a Gaussian measure. Or it is a formal expression for a Gaussian measure, which I will call denote mu zero. And you would like to define the interacting measure as absolutely continuous with respect to the Gaussian. And this has been done, so this is useful in many fields. It's useful in constructive quantum field theory, in the long-time dynamics of stochastic singular PDEs. And in closer to our context, it has been constructed and shown to be invariant in many contexts under the flow of this by, for example, Bourguin, Burg, Thomann, Zvedkov, Tadahiro, O, and Laurent Thomann. So there are many works on how do you make sense of this, and how do you prove that it's actually an invariant under the time evolution of this.
I'm still struggling with the new notation. So
yes.
You went from nu to k, and where is the operator n now? In the
it's when you expand the square. Okay. When you expand the square, my choice of nu, which I think I've left a bit implicit, is just so that when you expand the square over there, so the first term, the square of d gamma ek, gives you the original interaction. The square of the last term gives you the energy reference that I removed, and the cross product has the nu in it. It's the cross product which has the nu. Okay. So the first thing you define is the Gaussian measure. I don't know if it's a lemma or a definition. The natural thing to do is that you first define the mu zero m, which is, let me write minus Laplace plus kappa. So it will be actually the measure associated with minus Laplace plus kappa and not just minus Laplace, so maybe like this. And doesn't make a difference for the equation because this is conserved under the flow. So it's a tensor from j equals 1 to capital M. I wanted to write this. So of course these are the 2 pi k squareds, and these projections are projections on plane waves, but it just simplifies the notation to write it like that. This measure is a measure on the span of the big M first Fourier modes, and it's defined the way it should be. So it's lambda M over pi, I guess. Yes, e to the minus lambda m, and this, minus Laplace plus kappa. No, certainly not. And then it's d of the scalar product, which you should think of as d imaginary part times d real part. And that's a bona fide finite dimensional measure on the span of the first Fourier mode.
I'm sorry?
Yes?
Are you working on a finite domain or are you working on
a torus? Oh, okay. Torus all the time. So that's why I have this kappa which must be positive. And then, the lemma says that this mu zero m, I mean, there exists a unique mu zero, which, okay. Time is running very fast, so I'm just going to say it. It's in this case, on the three torus, it's a measure not over L2, but over. So it's a measure which leaves, it barely misses H minus half in the regularity. So H minus half is the Sobolev space of negative exponent half. And so there exists a unique measure like this, such that if you take its cylindrical projection on the span of the first Fourier modes, then you get mu zero m. You could define another way, but that's the way I will think of it. So that's the Gaussian part. And then there is the interaction part.
Oh, bad blackboard management. Where you still have a problem, because you see, this measure turns out it cannot be better. It's a theorem that it cannot be better. It turns out to charge only distributions. So W convoluted with U squared times U squared is problematic. But in fact, we know what to do. It's like, just like in the quantum model, you will remove a very big term from this term, which is not well defined, and the difference will be well defined. But here, at the level of the limit theory, it really means removing an infinite term. So it's really a true renormalization, if you want. Okay. So the interacting measure. I'm going to denote, so perhaps it's a lemma again, dr of u sub m is going to be a function of u, so it's going to be this double integral. I take pm of u squared, where pm is the guy which projects on the big M first Fourier mode, evaluated at x. And then you should take some inspiration from this, is that each time you see something which is going to be large or infinite in the limit, well, you remove its expectation in the free Gibbs state. So, which I will denote here, I remove the expectation of the same quantity in the Gaussian measure. So I hope the notation is clear. It's the same notation as in the quantum case. By this, I mean expectation in this measure that I just defined. So at m equal infinity, both terms are completely ill-defined, but the difference at m finite is well-defined, and the limit makes sense, actually. So then you complete everything you would like to have. You have the same quantity, pmu, at y squared minus the expectation of the same thing in mu zero, and we take at dx dy. So you see the true interaction, you just would not have this term, but I just remove it. And then the lemma says, in this form it's a very simple lemma actually, that dmr, it converges to some dr strongly in L1 of the Gaussian measure when m goes to infinity. And that's the definition of the interaction I will put in the interacting measure. So I had planned to give you a few words on how this works, but I have absolutely no time left. So just one comment is that something which makes it very easy in our case compared to other cases is that W has positive Fourier transform. So the original interaction was non-negative. This renormalized one is still non-negative, because if you write it in Fourier, it's integral of W hat of k times the square. So and that makes it very convenient. It's just one line to prove this once you, if you know Gaussian calculations, because the only thing you need to know is you compute the expectation of this in the Gaussian measure, figure out it's finite, and then you are in good shape. Then you have to prove the sequence is Cauchy, but it's not much more difficult. Okay, so that's the... Perhaps I can put this here then. The definition of the true measure mu du is 1 over little z, which is a normalization, mu 0 du exponential minus this renormalized interaction. Yes, it certainly is, yes. And that's because I have a smeared guy here. If I were doing 5-4-3, as you well know, it will not be that simple. But you see, this is actually simpler than 5-4-2, even though I'm 2D. And by the way, this particular case, the invariance of the measure has been proved by Bourguin in the 90s, and I think it was revisited by O and Thoman recently. So it's okay, now I barely have time to state the theorem. Okay. Let me recall yet another definition, density matrices from Matthew Stokes. You take a gamma positive, so a state, trace 1. So it's an operator self-adjoint on the Fock space with trace 1. You define its k-body density matrix, which is an operator on L2 symmetric of t now to the k. So it has k particles. Well, t3 to the k. Unit torus k times. And the definition is, so that's what I'm defining, for all operator AK bounded if you reach, for all operator on this space, the definition is a trace of AK against gamma K is the trace of the natural lifting of this operator to the Fock space. So, namely, you take the big sum for little n larger than k, then the sum over all i1 ik, and you take ak, by which I mean this notation means the operator ak acting on the variables i1 to ik, and then expectation in gamma. And that defines an operator, which is gamma k, and it's the same that Mathieu had in his lecture. So it's really the way, so if you want the k-particle marginal, that's the way you keep information about just k particles at a time. Okay, then the theorem, and I will have to stop here. So this is with Mathieu and with Nam, and it was also obtained independently almost the same with by the four people I noted over there. So let me state three statements. First thing you might be interested in is the behavior of the partition function. So the z lambda, which normalizes the thing, because the minus log z lambda times temperature is the free energy. So, but what is relevant here is the difference between minus log z lambda and minus log z zero. So this difference. And so the free energy is this multiplied by t, but then I divide by t because that's the correct thing to do. And it converges to minus log little z, where little z is this number which makes this mu a probability measure. Okay, and it's very important to look at the difference because each term takes separately the divergence very fast. Then I have a statement about the density matrices. So it's a straight, so the convergence, you see, because there is some renormalization, because things are singular, the natural topology on these guys is in the trace class operators, but the limit object will not be trace class. So I'd better take the limit in a different topology, and what we can do is Hilbert-Schmidt. So namely, perhaps I write it exactly, so it's take this, times lambda, gamma lambda k, factorial k is just here for decoration. Then the difference is you take the integral d mu u on this projector, which is the natural density matrix associated with this guy. Then square, this goes to zero. When t to infinity, which is the same as lambda to zero. Perhaps lambda to zero. And the square here is inside the trace, right? So it's a Hilbert-Schmidt norm that goes to zero. And then I have a last result. Well, we have a last result. which is about just the first density matrix. Now I'm going to write it like that. If you take the first density matrix, but now you don't take it alone, you remove the first density matrix of the non-interacting state. So taken separately, they can converge only Hilbert-Schmidt, or in fact better than Hilbert-Schmidt, but certainly not trace class. But the difference converges, so this is my notation for trace class, and it's strongly in the trace class, so in trace class norm, this converges to what it should be, to what it should, so the integral of this projection on U, and then the difference between the Gibbs measures. Okay. And now, the before stopping, the so I have plenty of comments to make, but I suggest that we take them as questions if there are any, because I'm over time. This is important physically, because when you say I want to look at the transition between before BEC, what you want to look is at is the density, and the density will be the trace, or the particle number will be the trace of this operator. So if you want to say something about the critical density, you have to be able to take traces. And then the objects are not trace class. So what you do is that you take the trace of the difference, and you see that the trace of the difference converges to what it should. So it really tells you that if you were doing this like physicists do in the proper thermodynamic then dilute limit, it tells you that the shift in critical density when you switch interactions on is given to leading order by classical fields. And that's really something that is due to Baim, Holtzman, and these people I mentioned before. And they are my main source of information about this is Marcus Holtzman, and he's really adamant that yes, it is the difference that must converge, and you should never look in this sort of regime as just one guy taken alone. Okay, so I had planned to give you some hints of the proof, but of course, too late. Thank you for your attention.
Questions or comments?
Does your construction of the measure also work when you put the other sign of the chemical potential?
Sorry?
Does your construction of the measure maybe also work if you put the other sign of the chemical potential? If you want to go into the symmetry broken phase, then the chemical potential will have to have a different sign.
No, I don't think it works, because it would mean a plus here.
Okay.
So it would the measure will not be defined, which I think is natural, because it really means if you do this, I think that you would need to have a BEC, so that this measure should really blow up on the zero mode, or at least perhaps it can be interpreted.
Is it not stabilized by the quartic term? I mean, that's the usual idea one has.
At the level of the measure, at least, I really don't know how to do it. You could hope, maybe, that some part of the measure blows up and concentrates on the BEC, and that what's left can still be well defined. But that's very, very vague. I mean, I don't think I could formulate it properly.
Okay. Yes.
So the single particle, the spectrum of the single particle Laplacian is quite singular on the standard torus that you're using here. How much do your results depend on changing the torus or doing this on a different manifold? Are the constants different, or does something else?
I'm not exactly sure I understand your question, so let me give you an answer, and then if it doesn't answer your question, you can ask it again. Take minus Laplace plus kappa, replace it by some abstract h, for example, on the full space. Could be, for example, sinc minus Laplace plus a potential on L2 of R3. But it could be very abstract. In fact, we have a very abstract statement that I spared you for this talk. What we really need is trace H minus 2 finite. Right? So it's quite true in the 3 torus. It's barely wrong in the 4 torus, And on the full space, it depends on this trapping potential, which should increase fast enough at infinity. I don't remember the exponent, but...
Okay, so you're actually not using any fine scale information on the spectrum here. It's just
No, it's really the main assumption. Yeah. In fact, we need trace h to the minus 2 plus a little something to be finite, and then everything works.
Okay.
With error estimates that depend on these norms, but that's what we need.
So okay, then there is a question by Nikolai, yeah. And then I think the other question will be maybe for the...
So I have a quick question. Where do you use the positivity of the... Only in the lemma you use the positivity of the Fourier transform of the interaction, or also in other places?
In fact, it's very useful also to pass to the limit in the Indian energy. I mean, not the same lemma as yesterday, but it's very useful to us because we work variationally. So you take the variational principle associated with this. It's fairly, no, not easy, but you can prove that the classical free energy is an upper bound for the minimum. But to prove a lower bound, it's really extremely useful that you write it like this as a sum of positive terms, right? So. I mean, if you forget for a moment that everything depends on everything, that you have a lot of parameters going to infinity and to zero, so that you cannot really use compactness, I mean, you would like to say, okay, just Fatou. Fatou lemma, and this you get a lower bound in the liminf. But it cannot work like that because you have two parameters, but it's the spirit. So no, we do not use it only here, we use it all over the place, in fact.
And I joined the previous question. In fact, if you take a general manifold and make the construction, I think in the definition of mu zero, the constant people using in quantum gravity, Christophe maybe correct me, is a little bit different. They use a constant which is invariant under conformal changes of the metric. And my feeling is that you don't use this constant. It's really just a question of constant. For fixed metric, doesn't mm-hmm. make difference. But if you change the metric, then there is a conformal invariance. So I don't know how much it is relevant for you, but if you take a manifold, I think mu zero, the nature of mu zero is slightly different.
Yes, I agree.
It's ridiculous.
But you can make the same thing,
right? Yeah. I'm really, really, really thinking of Euclidean space, maybe with a potential.
So and all discussion makes sense. Yeah.
Okay, and so I suggest that we stop here because it's... just 5 very short minutes, right? Just to check. And then we'll get one.